I'm sitting there watching Federer, and I'm reading all these tweets saying how poorly Federer's playing. Federer playing not very well. Federer playing quite bad. And then, Madukaran, I'm Care Now. Follow him on the Twitters at AMKHERENOW. He put this up. This is the point that happened like right after, not long after I saw enough of those tweets saying Federer's not playing well at all. Take a look.
15 all. Outside the doubles alley.
The shot of the tournament. Even Boris Becker can't contain himself with his funny accent. Welcome to the Coffee Break Tennis Podcast. I am on like day three or four of being very sick. So we are doing a podcast again. No video. You wouldn't want to see me. You would be frightened of the sight of me. What has happened to me from the ravages of this cold or flu. I don't know, whatever it is. My hips are killing me. Aching muscle pain in the hips and the lower back. Probably how Roger Federer feels after a long tennis match. Like I said in the beginning, I'm kind of surprised how many people are saying Federer's playing terrible and he's gonna have no chance against Rafa. You see the thumbnail. My big question right now, from the confines of the Coffee Break Tennis compound, the headquarters, sick, hiding in the basement, in the bunker, watching tennis, getting shows out as fast as I can while I still have the energy to do so. My big question here today is, do Fed fans really want this match? We've heard forever that the Roger Rafa head-to-head, it's only that way, and I agree with this, I've been saying this forever too, it's only that way because Federer always wins enough to show up and meet him at the clay tournaments. Then at the faster tournaments, on the grass court tournaments, we know Rafa, he's always winning the French, so he often skips grass court tune-up events, and he's fallen short at Wimbledon many times where we all think Federer would have crushed him. But this year, as I can't remember who said it first, but somebody said, going from the orange clay, going from the red clay to the green clay. This is not grass, it's green clay. Well, it's slippery like blue clay, and we all know Federer is the king of blue clay. I'm not going to go ahead and say Federer can't beat Rafa here just yet, but the more I do watch Federer matches here and see how slow this is playing, the more I'm starting to feel like it's going to be a lot to ask. And Rafa, he looks incredible. Now, Luca Pui came out playing much better than Tsonga. In that third set, Luca Pui played much better than Tsonga. I think Pui got a little deflated in the second set. Didn't play as well. Federer was able to jump all over him. Pui was very tough, played good, was moving great. And again, the court is playing so slow, and Pui was moving so well, it was really hard for Federer to hit a ball past him. That's why you've seen Federer today hit behind Pui so much. Federer's best friend today, he did it when Pui was at the net, he did it when Pui was at the baseline. Whenever Pui would hit a good cross-court forehand, Federer would just redirect all that power, take the ball very early, and redirect all that power right back cross-court and hit behind Pui very often. That was where most of the Federer forehand winners were hitting behind Pui or just taking a forehand early up the line when Pui was way out of position, which did happen occasionally. But overall, Pui was able to get to a lot of Federer shots. There was some great play at the net. I was a little baffled by Federer coming to net a couple times and missing pretty bad at the net. If you'll remember this, Federer in the second set, he gets the three love, breaks 2-0, serves 3-0, and then breaks again for 4-0 with a couple. Now, Federer's backhand did abandon him today. Yes, I'll acknowledge that. That's true. If you're going to be critical of Federer today, we got to wonder, what's up with the backhand? Need to think a little bit about the backhand before the next match, Roger. That's something to address, maybe. But when he broke twice in the second set to get the 4-0, Federer ripped a backhand pass up the line, and then he hit an even more impressive backhand pass cross-court on the line. That was really a line clipper and a tough shot to pull off. So it's not like the backhand's hopeless or anything, but there were some very bad misses for Roger Federer on the backhand side. But after that, Federer's up 4-0. We're all starting to think bagel. And he's up 30 love, I want to say, serving 4-0, trying to get to that 5-0. And then He comes to net up 30 love, 2 points in a row. And the first one, it looks like he overthought it. He was trying to be too fancy. Like, he went up there and was like, am I going to drop it? Or am I going to fake like I'm going to drop it and then push it to the baseline behind Puy? Like, Federer came up there, and we see this in the early rounds. Federer likes to play around with his opponents. When he has a big lead, he's up a set 4-0. Perfect time, serving 4-0 in a set up. That's the perfect time for Federer to work on some things that he might want to try to pull out against Rafa, which maybe we'll see Dirty Dan pull some dirty tricks on Rafa. Hopefully Dirty Dan is he winning? He's serving for the third set right now, although he's 15-30. God, all Fed fans out there, pray that Dirty Dan comes through here, because even if he loses the Rafa, you'll learn a lot as the Federer team for game planning against Rafa. You'll learn a lot from that match for how it's going to work on this surface here. Anyways, so Federer, it's like he overthought that volley and pushes it long, and it just looks kind of ugly. And it's clearly he was like thinking about what's he going to do, this or that, and he got confused. And then the second volley, I can't remember, but it was another one that it was just bad. It was bad. So that kind of stunned me. Not too much, but because, you know, Federer does this. Like I said, we see it a lot. In the early rounds, he does this. Maybe Puy, even though he's had a rough year, he looked more like the Puy from the Australian Open today. Not exactly, but closer to that than the terrible Puy we've seen, the Misha Zverev-like Puy we've seen all year. He looked more like that Puy overall, so maybe just put him to bed, Roger. Maybe don't try out some dirty tricks. Maybe don't experiment with him because you got a big lead on him, because he is dangerous. The guy was moving great. The guy was striking the ball very well. Missed too many serves, missed too many forehands. Roger really needs to send a thank you card from week two to the Puy forehand. It was nice that Federer was able to go with the second serve to the forehand and keep his second serve win percentage up pretty high still. We'll look at the stats in a second. I think it's maybe 58%, which is pretty good second serve. It was really good, really. It's just Federer was averaging 75 after two rounds, so doesn't seem as good compared to 75. 58, very good. Anyways, where were we? What was I saying? Where were we going? The bottom line here is Federer played a great match. Rafa played a great match, too. Tsonga was pretty awful. Okay, I wanted to be nice on Twitter, and I said, Tsonga didn't have his greatest match ever. And a couple people came out and just said, they just straight up said the Tsonga was terrible. I don't know. I think maybe the court being slow, and, you know, you're facing Rafa. It's easy to be disheartened when you see Rafa on the other side of the net. You know, Federer said it at the French Open. Middle of the match, he's thinking to himself, who am I supposed to hit with? Because you go and find a hitting partner who's a lefty, kind of like Rafa, can recreate the feel of the Rafa ball for you. It's not possible. No one hits the ball like Rafa, especially when Rafa is on. And Federer joked, you know, he said in the middle of the match, he was thinking, like, who am I supposed to hit with to get ready for this guy? Many great men have been disheartened by Rafa. So Tsonga didn't really show up. Was it because Rafa is so imposing? Was it because the court is so slow? It's like, how the heck am I going to be? I'm basically playing Rafa on green clay. This sucks. Maybe that's what went through Tsonga's head in a French version of it. Something like that. So Rafa's playing great. How good is Rafa? We need to see someone who has the weapons to hurt Rafa playing really well. We did see Kyrgios with the weapons to hurt Rafa playing really well at times. I mean, someone commented to me, Matt, Federer winning, because I pointed out in the last podcast, oh, and we'll talk about the court speed. A lot of people disagree with me on the court speed. We'll get to that in a little bit. Somebody was saying to me, Matt, it's not as impressive that Federer is winning more on second serve because he played a couple qualifiers. Whereas Rafa, and remember, qualifiers are battle-tested. But yes, you do want to play qualifiers. That is nice. But remember, Rafa played Kyrgios, who has one of the worst returns on tour. He breaks less often than everyone. He tanks return games regularly. So that could inflate the Rafa numbers to be higher win on second serve percentage than they really are. Don't forget that. So give credit to Roger Federer putting up a 75 after two rounds. 75% win on second. That's still a great number. It's still a great sign. He's hitting spots with the second serve. He's been doing it all year. It's not a fluke. It's not because of a couple qualifiers. He did pretty good with Puy today. obviously not the greatest. The numbers in the second set are really bad for Federer on the second serve win percent. They're like 38, something horrendous. Probably part of it is that one horrible game. It's weird. How do you have your worst numbers there, but that's the set where it was kind of beat down city. You're up 4-0, almost 5-0. It was kind of weird. But anyways, just wanted to point that out. You know, Kyrgios did tank a return game. He admitted it in the press conference. There was a return game that he just didn't even try. So that'll help your serve numbers if you're Rafa there. Anyway, so we need to see someone who's really on and bring in a big game. And we would like, as Federer fans, if you're not a Federer fan, if you're a Rafa fan, think of it like this. If you're on the Federer team, if you're a coach, you would like to see Dirty Dan play Rafa, break out his dirty tricks. Speaking of dirty tricks.
Cocaine is a hell of a drug.
Patrick McEnroe said, a couple years ago, Dan Evans, you know, this is a great story. He's coming back. He had a cocaine suspension, tested for cocaine. And the other commentator, God bless him, he goes, shh, don't say that. Look, we can't fault Dirty Dan. We're all human. Even the people on the tennis tour. We're all human. We all love the sweet taste of the sweet candy. Don't hate the man. Love him. He's a great guy, Dirty Dan. And he plays pretty similar to Federer. Some of the stuff he does the win here. So if you see that go up against Rafa, great way to game plan. Let me drink. No coffee. Wellness tea and a lot of water. Because I'm just falling apart over here. I'm spilling water on myself. Mr. Goat is looking at me like he's wondering, how long can I hang on? Will I be able to feed him tomorrow? Don't worry, Mr. Goat. I'll power through this. You know, I'm thankful for a middle Sunday. In the past, when I was younger, I'd be very frustrated. Think, come on, people are off work on Sunday. This is the perfect time to watch tennis. Why isn't there tennis at Wimbledon on the middle Sunday? Now I'm very appreciative of middle Sunday. Everyone gets a break. We all get to relax. We enjoyed a lot of tennis. Step back. Look at the big picture. Be grateful for this wonderful time of year that we get Wimblemas. Let's look at some stats. Not a lot of aces. Three aces for Fed, three aces for Puy. Why? Because the court is ridiculously slow. Screw the stats. Let's address this thing, because a lot of people said, Matt, you're wrong. The court doesn't speed up. I'm not 100% sure, because I've played on grass one time in my life, and it was pretty fast. I remember hitting backhand so late. I hit a backhand so late that it went over the side fence. It was one of those short fences, not like it went way up. But I hit a backhand so late, it just went sideways over the fence. So yeah, it plays fast. But that grass is different than Wimbledon grass. Halle plays faster. Queen's Club looked pretty similar to Wimbledon. What I've always heard, forever, is that they play more like hard courts as they wear down. The grass courts do. Federer said it himself. I want to say in the press conference before the tournament starts, Roger says, you know, as you get into it, you can play more from the baseline. The courts wear down and play more like a hard court. Therefore, you get to move easier. So it's easier to get the footing because it's not as slippery and slick and slidey as the grass. I know the bounce can be a little more unpredictable as the court wears because some spots wear more than others. So that's another thing as grass wears down. Sometimes they'll hit a grassy patch. Sometimes they'll hit a patch that's just all dirt. So the bounce can kind of change, and that can make things a little tricky. So that's going to benefit, I would say, Djokovic and Roger the most because they've got the best timing. Therefore, they'd be able to pick it up even with a different bounce, a little cleaner maybe. I don't know, though. You know, we saw what Rafa did in the wind. The way Rafa hits the ball with so much margin and so much spin, maybe that benefits him more. That's a tough call there because, you know, you could argue that, well, Rafa's shot, even if the ball's moving sideways in wind or bouncing funny, he's going to be able to pick it up. And I'm thinking of the match yesterday with Djokovic. There was one short forehand that he totally missed because it bounced kind of funny, and he looked really annoyed. And there was a ball today where Federer missed a backhand, and he actually yelled out. What did he say? He said, like, come on. He wasn't happy. Whatever. He yelled something. He's like, oh, my God. Gott in Himmel. He said something like, I can't remember what he said. But he yelled out when he missed his backhand. It was because it was a mishit from Puy. And when it hit the grass, it bounced really weird, and Federer didn't like it. So maybe that's bonus for Rafa. As far as the court speeding up, I thought the court would speed up a little as it wears down because, you know, the grass keeps it lower. The bounce will get higher, like Federer said. The court plays more like a hard court as it wears out. Now, maybe back in the day, grass plays way faster than a hard court. Saying that means that it's going to play slower because it's now it's more like a hard court, which is slower than grass, which is super fast back then. But when you think about it today and the way Federer said it, Federer was saying, you know, the U.S. Open, the rallies are, on average, they're less shots. The courts are playing faster at the U.S. Open than here on grass. And we think of the U.S. Open as the slower of the two hard courts. It's slower than the Australian Open, that's for sure. And then Federer is saying it's going to play more like a hard court as the grass wears away. And he's saying the hard courts are faster. So that sounded to me like he's saying the courts are going to speed up a little and he's going to like it better in week two. Anyways, I don't know. Like I said, I've never played at Wimbledon. I've only played on one grass court, the grass court at Bahamar in the Bahamas with Crunch Time coaching genius, and lover of the game, Peter Freeman. Anyways, let's go to the stats. So that's all I got for you on the surface. It always seems to me like it speeds up a little, but you know what? A part of that is probably because who's there at the end at week two when the courts are worn down? The best players in the world who are either, you know, Isner and Anderson crushing the ball last year. That might make it seem like it's going faster than it really is. And Djokovic and Federer, precision timing, taking the ball on the center of the strings early. And that looks like a very fast ball too, even if they don't have quite as much raw power as Rafa, who might be in the second week crushing the ball. So it always looks a little faster to me as you get into it, but that might be more about you got bigger, stronger players. The bottom line is it's not going to change too much. That brings me back to my question. Do Federer fans really, comment below, do Federer fans really want to see Fedal here on what some call green clay? I'm still undecided on that. I think we watch some of the stuff Federer is able to do here, the redirecting of the ball, taking the ball early, playing so well at the net, using the low bounce to his advantage, and I think, and the bounce should get higher, but will it get a lot higher? It probably won't get a whole lot higher, we hope. I think that gives Roger a real shot here. But the slowness of the court, there's no denying it. These rallies are going longer than Roger wants. He clearly was frustrated at times today. He has been every single match. Luca Puig, a big, strong young guy who moves really well, who can do some stuff like what you might see from Rafa. You know, he's hitting big forehands, and he was getting to everything, and he was playing pretty aggressive. And obviously, he won't sustain it the way Rafa will. He won't make as many dumb mistakes as, he'll make more silly mistakes than Rafa will. Roger won't be able to just hit a second serve to the forehand, kind of tight to the body, and get out of trouble fast with Rafa. So we got a lot of reasons to worry there as Fed fans. But we shall see. We still got to see more stuff. And Matteo Berrettini is not going to be easy at all. We'll look at the draw in a second. Let's go through the stats really quick. So like I said, aces, not a lot of them. No double faults from Federer. That's a good sign. I mean, he's serving very well. 75% first serve in. Win on first serve, 85. That's great. That's right up there with the very best of the tournament. Win on second, 67. That's still a great number. Oh, I'm looking at set three numbers. Let's look at the full match. Let's start over. The numbers are still great. 70% first serve in. Federer is usually closer to 60. So 70, he's getting a lot in. Win on first serve, 76. Not as good as the number we saw. So set three was great. 85 and 67. The whole match is 76. That's still good. But that definitely came a lot down. And again, that has a lot to do with Puig is a better player than the first two guys. And this court is super slow. And Puig is a very athletic guy who can get to a lot of balls. Win on second serve, 58. It's still a very good number for win on second serve compared to the tour. The net points, 72%. Roger, very good at the net. Missed a few. Every match, he's had a couple points at the net where I just thought, how did he miss that? What the heck? Is he overthinking it? Break points, Federer's pretty good, 44%, 4 out of 9. Did a lot of breaking here. Winners, 39, 14 on forced errors. I mean, Federer's playing very clean. He's just clearly frustrated by how slow this is and how long everything's taking. All right, that's enough stats. Take a look at the draw. Sam Querrey and Tennis Sandgren, both guys that have, you know, we've been talking about this season, like Matteo Berrettini. The big guys with the power, they can take advantage of this surface, and they got to be solid, though, because especially here, because the court's playing slower. But it still does help you with the ball staying so low, especially if you can flatten that ball out. If you can play courageous big tennis and you can be consistent enough to knock down several shots, well, Tennis Sandgren is definitely doing that right now. Sam Querrey, the serve is unreal, and he's doing that. What a shame those guys got to play each other, because those guys are probably a much bigger threat to Rafa, if you were one of those people that doesn't want Rafa to win here because you love Federer so much. If you're a Rafa fan, this is good. So you get Dirty Dan or Susapalooza, those guys are going to be a lot easier. Although Dirty Dan could be very tricky for Rafa. He could do some of the things that we'd see Roger do on a grass court that could trouble Rafa. Even a slower grass court, even though it's playing super slow, there's still a lot of options to you. The low bounce gives you a lot of things you can do with the drop shots, come in the net. Sam Querrey, Tennis Sandgren, those guys are going to duke it out. They'll come through and probably play Rafa. I can't imagine him not getting through Dan Evans. Oh, my. Dirty Dan lost the third set. It's probably going to be Susapalooza. So, bad news for Fed fans right there. Sam Querrey, can he beat Rafa? Rafa's going to be so full of confidence by the time they get to the quarterfinals. I don't know. That is a tough call right there. Sam Querrey definitely has the game that we usually see trouble Rafa on grass. So, still some danger for Rafa, but you got to be feeling really good if you're a Rafa fan right now. Really, really good. The guy looks incredible. Let's look at Federer. He comes through Puy. So, like I said, if Schwartz can really wear Berrettini down, that could help Roger Federer out a lot, because Berrettini is dangerous. He's very good. He's a young guy. Federer hasn't played him. Luckily for Federer, with the big data analytics, a lot of grass court matches this season for Berrettini. He won in Stuttgart. Oh, what did Berrettini do next? I cannot remember. Did he lose? No, he beat Struff and Halla. And then he lost the cousin Fed, I think, David Goffin. Yeah, David Goffin took down Berrettini and Halla. So that's enough grass court matches, plus here at Wimbledon, to get some big data analytics. Because, you know, sometimes it seems like Federer doesn't like playing these guys for the first time, although he always does beat up on the young guys too. But in early matches, Federer plays a guy. It's really because you're going to have data on Berrettini. You're going to be able to game plan against this guy. Sometimes Federer plays some guy who plays on the Challenger Tour. That's a little tougher to game plan. And sometimes Federer will beat these guys, but will look like, you know, it's not his favorite thing. He's a little unsure of how to play these guys, and he's kind of feeling them out for a little while. So with Berrettini, he should have plenty of info, even though this is their first meeting. Berrettini didn't use his slice as much from what I saw. I saw a good bit of Schwartzman, but I was mostly watching the Nadal and the Federer matches today. But I did see a good bit of the Berrettini-Schwartzman match. Didn't see as much slicing from the backhand from Berrettini. Maybe that's because Schwarty D is the schwartest guy on tour and wasn't bothered by the low slice. Maybe he liked it. Maybe it just kind of let him... One slice in particular I saw was, yeah, it was a low slice, but it was a little short. And Schwarty D stepped in and took the ball, took it on big time, went real aggressive. So maybe Berrettini wanted to stay away from that. But I noticed more two-hand backhands than I've been seeing all grass court season for Berrettini in that match. What will he do with Federer? The Luca Puy slice backhand at times did seem to, I don't want to say treble Federer, but it didn't look like it was the easiest thing in the world for Federer to handle at times. Overall, nothing he did really worked, because Federer wins in straight sets. But will Berrettini go with the slice backhand a lot at Roger Federer? Is that a matchup he wants to get in, backhand to backhand? Probably, you would think, the way to go, and what we've seen the young guys do in the first two rounds, Clark and Lloyd Harris, was big inside-out forehands. We saw Puy doing it. Big inside-out forehands to the Federer backhand, so I think we'll probably see a lot of that from Berrettini. Berrettini's giant, massive serve makes you wonder if you could see a match like that Tsonga match in, I think it was 2011, where Tsonga comes back from two sets down to beat Federer, just because Federer could do nothing with the serve. Now, Berrettini just went through the longest match of the tournament. So, Fed fans, we get our wish. Schwarty D really worked Berrettini hard in this match. Berrettini looked very frustrated at times, but at the end, when he won, he looked like it was the happiest moment of his entire life. Guy likes playing on grass. The guy's got a very dangerous serve. He's got a pretty good slice backhand. Slice backhands don't tend to trouble Roger Federer, so we'll see how that plays out. And Berrettini's got a real cannon of a forehand. And like I said, he's one of those guys who has been very on. He was a little off when he lost to David Goffin, cousin Fed the Gopher, and Halla. A little off at times there. Will we get that here? A little off at times with Schwartz D? maybe a little tired, maybe not because he's super young. A lot of question marks there. This is going to be the big danger match for Roger Federer on Monday, so keep your eyes on that one. I feel like I'm going to go into a coughing fit, so let me take a sip of the water. The Kuschmeister took down Struff, which is good, because Struff is another kind of dangerous guy for Roger to play here. Big serve, big forehand, slice backhand, could come to net. Berrettini looks pretty good at net, too, here on the grass. So that guy's gone. Thanks, Kuschmeister, for the Fed fans. Felix Auger didn't get through and give us the Djokovic-Felix match that we were all hoping for. And not Air Bear, Umber. They'll learn to say your name when you've really made the big time. That's how tennis works. So if we're wrong, if he beats Djokovic, we'll definitely learn his name for sure. Felix Auger, like I said, guys, you know, good shot selection, beautiful movement. He's one of the best movers around at this age. Big serving for a young man, especially. But 29 double faults. I think I said in the last video or one of the videos, I said, you know, Felix, great, but sometimes the execution, he just, some misses where you just think, like, how did he not make that shot? And 29 double faults. Only one crazy person is even close to that number. And it's Benoit Paire at 23. Verdasco's got 20 as well. Umber's got 17. I mean, he's on that list, tied for 7th place. But 29, that's a lot more. I mean, almost doubled it. And 17's not a number to be happy with. So, I mean, what can you expect? I figured since you got another young guy, that was a pretty good draw for Felix. And we would get the Djokovic-Felix match, but we won't get it. Now, is Umber going to be able to challenge Djokovic? I doubt it. Her catch really did. I mean, that first set. Let me bring up my match notes because this match is from yesterday. And who can remember stuff from yesterday? So a couple things I wrote down when I was watching the her catch, Rhymes of Latch, and Djokovic match. Ooh, that's a doozy. Was Djokovic has more unforced errors in the first set than her catch does. I mean, this really is like a set that he kind of snuck away. The double faults have been creeping in at bad times for Djokovic. This happened a lot this year after he wins the Australian Open. And I wasn't, you know, early on at the Australian Open, Djokovic didn't play like the way he did towards the end when he destroyed Rafa in that final. So we could get that Djokovic here still. It's not impossible, but I haven't been completely convinced by Djokovic all year since then. At the French Open, same deal, and if, sure enough, he lost to Dominic Thiem earlier than you expected Djokovic to lose. A lot of people are saying Nadal's going to win it, but Djokovic has a chance to beat Nadal, and some people thought Djokovic would win four in a row, but obviously he didn't. The double faults creep in. I think I didn't write in my match notes. I don't know why, but I want to say Djokovic was serving to stay in. I think he was serving 4-5 maybe in the first set. And the double fault comes in. He's down maybe love 30. I mean, just sloppy stuff. Also, forehands. This is the thing with Djokovic. Either he double faults or missing a lot of first serves or missing spots at least. And then forehand unforced errors out of nowhere. And we saw some of that in the first set. Then when Hubi Hurkacz had to serve to stay alive, that's when Djokovic really turned it on a return game where he's most comfortable. And he takes care of business. Serving to get into the second set tiebreaker. Same thing, very loose forehand, unforced error. We're at 30 all of a sudden. Now, he does get to the tie break, but then a double fault creeps in at the worst time, and he loses a set. This, I believe, one of my favorite stats guys out there brought to my attention that this is the first time Nadal, Federer, and Djokovic have all dropped a set in the first week of Wimbledon. I think the first time ever, or at least the first time in a long time. I want to say first time ever. Anyways, you get my point. It doesn't matter too much. It's a strange thing, right? They're getting older. Still no sign that they're not going to beat everyone. Definitely should be more worried about Federer than anyone of the big three. But Djokovic doesn't look perfect to me. So will Umbert be able to challenge as hard as Hurkacz, who had a couple of the best points of the tournament? I know I started to show off saying Federer has the best point of the tournament, but Hurkacz rhymes with latch. He had a diving backhand volley, drop winner. He had some crazy stuff. I do want to highlight one of my own tweets because I just thought of this is probably the longest description of a shot of all time, and that just goes to show you. Here's what I wrote. Federer hit the shot of the tournament, a cross-court forehand flick winner passing shot on the run outside of the doubles alley. There you go. So clearly that's the best shot because it has the most descriptive words. You can't just say that shot without all of those words because all of those are key. It was cross-court. It was a forehand. It was a flick. It was a clean winner. It was a passing shot. It was on the run, and it came from outside of the doubles alley. So that's the shot of the tournament. But Hurkacz did have a couple incredible points against Djokovic. He threw everything he had at him. It wasn't enough. The court is so slow. It demands that you play perfect. Reminds me of Del Potro and the super slow U.S. Open, unable to hit a ball past Djokovic. So it does look like Djokovic has a great chance. But there is one little man who is playing very good right now, who is moving well enough, playing patient enough, and taking the opportunities when they are there on this slow grass. And that is Cousin Fed, David Goffin. If he beats Verdasco, we will get a Djokovic. If Djokovic beats Humbert, we'll get a Goffin-Djokovic quarterfinal, which could be really something special. I think David Goffin can challenge here. Guido Pella and Raonic. Amazing that Pella's got this far. This is a guy who likes clay better. More proof that this is very slow grass. Raonic will get through Pella. Batista Agut, Benoit Paire, Benoit Paire. Tough call there. Surprised Benoit Paire's there, maybe. Although, I think I did in my prediction, I put him pretty far, didn't I? Mainly because I like him. These guys are both playing well here. Benoit Paire, definitely more firepower. Bigger weapons. Batista Agut, way solid and less crazy. Way more solid in the mind. If you have to pick, you probably go with Batista Agut here. And you pick Raonic to come through. You pick Djokovic to come through Goffin, even though Goffin's playing very well. And you give Raonic a chance to beat Djokovic, although the court is playing so slow. But you know what? Raonic, he had his one Wimbledon final, 2016. And he played a Djokovic-like guy in Andy Murray. And maybe he'll come a little bit more prepared knowing what he should do this time around. And he'll get a second crack at the finals. What a story that would be. Excuse me. If Federer made the finals and he had a second crack at beating Miloš at Wimbledon. Although, didn't he pound Miloš into the ground in 2017 or last year? Anyways, he'll get a rematch at Miloš in a big match. Will that happen? Yeah, probably wishful thinking. Will we get Joker and Rafa? That's what a lot of people think. Thanks for listening to the show. I'm going to get out of here before I pass out. Comment below. The big question, if you're a Federer fan, do you really want to see Roger and Rafa play here? I still do, but the more I watch this court, the more nervous I get for Roger Federer. Thank goodness we will not be here tomorrow because it is Middle Sunday, but we will definitely be here for Manic Monday. I have to teach tennis on Manic Monday, as well as watch the tennis and make the show, which of course takes time. So it might be very late at night that we post, but you better believe we're going to be there for Manic Monday. See ya!